try and put your market so that you've got, if you're going to be practicing things like leans against order flow and deltas and things like that, you've got to make sure you've got your demo account open so that you can practice without worrying about the outcomes. You're practicing. It's not that you think it's the real deal. It's not going to be the same pressure, but it's the way you practice. It's the way you gain confidence so that when you go live, you're not as worried. Okay, so this is the euro. This is the setup you want to have. It's a 1 minute chart. You can obviously take it lower time frames if you so desire. And what you're trying to do here is you're just trying to recognize the structure of a marketplace. You're trying to recognize how deltas work. You're trying to recognize where you could have done some business at certain points. One of the things that you start to look for is you start to recognize the idea of the liquidity order book. You start to look at things like the deltas getting jammed in certain prices. You start looking at the value that you've got on your screens as well in terms of your outright values. And by doing that, what you end up doing is start looking for opportunities to maybe take advantage of the value that's setting up. We can see at the bottom edge, for example, here, there's no buyers and there's no real sellers. So you could do anything you want down here. Now, obviously, at the bottom edge here, you want to be looking at that and saying, okay, that's that measured move. I want to be buying it. So you could have taken advantage of an easy money buy and made some about 14 ticks worth of profit. It's pretty good. As we catch up with the right-hand side, of course, as I said, I've softened the block trade so that we get a lot of block trade information. It may be too much block trade information for some of you, but I wanted to see more rather than less. I wanted to see more stuff on the screens rather than less stuff on the screens. And again, we can see the deltas. We can see that the delta has quite a strong upside here. There's a very strong kind of buy side delta. So at the moment, it's going to be very difficult to be selling this, isn't it? The buyers seem to be confident. In fact, the price actually dropped through the bottom edge here and the buyers didn't throw away their positions. So that's a piece of information that you can look at and say, why did they not throw away their positions when the price broke the lows here? Is that telling me something? Is that telling me that I should have been buying into this low print down here? Well, let's take a look at the euro and let's see what our thoughts are in terms of the analysis. When it comes to the analysis, we can already recognize that this is a change of behavior level just here. It was a capper price in the background. We saw that we got the capper, we got the toxic reversal, we had the slow money reversal coming back down again. We then saw the fast money break north. So we've got two pieces of toxic evidence that there's a buy trade here, right? It's pretty easy, isn't it? Two pieces of evidence that there's a toxic buyer in this area. So this could have been a buy opportunity for anybody just purely looking at the price action. There could have been a buy opportunity to strike into that. When we see that opportunity, we can obviously look at this now and we can see, well, unfortunately, we never got a lean right at the very bottom tick price. Now, the other things we want to look at is we want to look at the value. What value do we use for a euro dollar? Well, we could use lots of things. We could use the pound dollar. We want to know whether the euro dollar is cheaper, because if the euro dollar is cheaper and the pound dollar is bullish, then of course, there's absolutely no chance that we're probably on the wrong trade. So we can take advantage of that, of course. Now, you might say, but that could be a sell in a pound. Yeah, but we need other evidence. So the first thing we want to look at when we're looking at these things is the pound dollar, just to see what the dollar crosses are doing. And the pound dollars went north side big style, right? So anybody that's looking for a trade, they would either be selling the pound or they'd be buying the euro, wouldn't they? So that's pretty obvious. That's not difficult to see. If you're going to be shorting the market against the dollar, you'd be selling pounds. If you're going to be buying the market against the dollar, you're going to be buying euros. So that's two reasons why the buyer would want that lower price, correct? That's two reasons why the buyer would want the lower price. The first reason was the lack of any sellers. The second reason, well, we've also got the structure. The second reason was the toxic structure. So that's the second reason. The third reason is the pound's already gone bullish. So that's us now got three reasons to be buying the euro at lower prices. What else? Well, of course, the carry trade would be useful to know. And the carry trade is the 10 spreads. So if we look at the 10 spreads, the question is the carry trade bullish? Yes, the carry trade is on an upside trend line. We can see that from this low print here, the carry trade is definitely bullish at lower prices. It has to be into the lower price though, because it's also got a bearish trend coming in, but that's confirmed by the price. This isn't. So this is bullish at lower prices, correct? So that's another reason to be long the euro dollar. What else could we use? The pension fund line, the S&P versus the DAX. If we look at the S&P versus the DAX, the question is that bullish? It's not only bullish, it's very bullish. So we've now got another reason to buy the euro at lower prices. How many of these arrows do you want to see before you start buying some euros at lower prices? You know what I mean? Come on to grips, guys. Seriously. It's really, really easy to make money in the markets if you just follow if you follow the dots. So we've got so many reasons to buy the euro. It's unbelievable. So all you've got to do is make sure there's not any sellers coming in. The only downside, as I said, is the lack of a seller at lower prices that you can lean against. But that's because there's simply no sellers coming in, guys. There just wasn't any sellers. If there's no sellers, we can't manufacture sellers out of fresh air. It's just the fact there's nobody there. Nobody is stupid enough to sell it. Nobody's getting stopped out. Nobody's getting wiped out of the trade on a sweep. All the buyers know that they want to be buying. In fact, all the buyers are sitting wanting to buy even more trade at lower prices. Nobody sells. So obviously what happens is that all you've got to do is pick up a buy trade somewhere in here. Now, obviously, if you've not got a lien, you've not got a lien. You would have to start doing some bidding. And obviously, the takeaway from that trade's been pretty good. You've just traded into the capper price. And obviously, at the capper price, you're going to be taking that as a profit, and you're going to take that as a profit and loss opportunity to take some money. Based on the structure, of course, you've got to be looking at it from a big bracket, small bracket picture. There's two brackets involved in this market, isn't there? There's the bottom to top bracket, and then there's the halfback trade bracket, which is quite a sizable bracket in its own right. As far as targets, therefore, are concerned, the first target is always going to be the capper price. You can see that this halfback trade, which is another reason, of course, is the halfback comes in here. So there's the halfback trade level there, which was the perfect break. And the next part, so we already know where the target prices are in terms of structures. There's a target price that'll probably be sitting here, and then there's a big target. The big target price is going to be that price right here. So we've now got two price areas for targets, haven't we? So that's good news. What else have we got? Well, we've also got a bracket here. Now that bracket is basically that first pink line, because that's about the 50 target. That bracket is about that area. That's a rejection. That's not a bracket low. So this is really where I would be expecting to see the selling coming in from these three places. This one for the first target price, this one for the second target price, this one for the third target price. And obviously that buy trade, if we wanted to sell the market, we wouldn't be selling the euro, we'd be selling pounds, wouldn't we? So we obviously keep those elements in mind when we start developing out this storyline. Now, what else do we use? Well, the final thing we've been using has been the Aussie dollar. The Aussie dollar against the Japanese yen. If we've got the Aussie dollar against the Japanese yen, what do we want to see before we see it? What do we want to see before we see it? We want to see the Aussie yen rising. We want to see the green line, which is the Aussie yen euro dollar, rising faster. Okay, so that's what we want to see before we see it, right? So let's take a look at this bracket and see if that's what happens. We want to see the Aussie yen rising. Is the Aussie yen rising? Yes, it is. So we've got good news. We've got an unwind of the kind of a beta hedgers, the low beta hedgers. So the buyers of dollars who buy because of the risks coming into the markets. If the Aussie yen's away up there's no way you're going to be buying dollars to hedge out your betas, right? So that's not going to be the trade. So that's good news. The second good news is we've got a little ledge here. Now, obviously, if the green line has gone above that ledge there, that would be brilliant, wouldn't it? Because that's exactly what Reeves looking for, is a buy trade on the euro. So let's take a look and see if the green line made a higher high from that point to point level. Did the green line make a higher high from that point to point level, Reeve? Drum roll. Yes, it did. Drum roll comes in. Buyers pour in. You get the perfect situation right there. You pick up the buy trade and boom, straight into profit. And obviously the profit takings came in a little bit hard, probably because of what reason? Because it's the value's got too big. This is always the things that you've got to try and remember. If you've seen the value changing quickly on the right-hand edge, it's dead easy. You join the trade as quickly as you can. You're involved in the transition. If the value transitioned hours ago, potentially, if the value transitioned half an hour ago, if the value transitioned 20 minutes ago, 15 minutes ago, and the value is still very, very bullish or very, very bearish, the chances are that people will see it not as an outright, but as a spread hedge trade. For that reason, the more value you've got, the less outcomes you'll get from the deal. You've all heard me mentioning this many times by now, surely to goodness. You've heard me mentioning this 1,000 billion times. The more value that's in a trade, the less outcome you're going to make. So whilst this has huge value, there's a very good chance that there's going to be a huge seller coming in at this price. Why? Because there's going to be a seller coming in at this price to hedge out that exposure. So they're going to buy here, they're going to take profits here, they're going to sell here. That's going to push the price back down again. They're going to buy here, they're going to push it back up, they're going to sell here, take profits here, and they're going to push it back down again. The chances are this price might not make much of a break outside this bracket at all. There's always that chance because the value is too much. And obviously the value against the Aussie yen is not the one that everybody would be paying attention to. The value that people would be paying attention to is, of course, more likely to be the pound dollar. So we could obviously understand the pound dollar is probably the big problem for this trade. The pound dollar at that top edge is almost a no-brainer sell opportunity. So you're buying euros, the price is rising, you're taking profits on your euro dollar here and you're selling pound dollar. And that's pushing the pound dollar down now from that sell profit. See what's happened? So the prices went up and the pound's been a sell right there. So you're buying euros on the downtick, you're selling pounds on the uptick, and you're beginning to get into basically a euro-pound position, not a euro-dollar position. Because you're on the euro-pound, of course, this isn't the chart you're trading. This is not the chart you're trading. You're trading a different chart altogether. The euro-pound. You're buying euro-pound effect, not because you're legging into euro-pound, of course, but you're basically buying a euro-pound position. So you're trading a different chart with a different narrative. You're not actually trading the euro dollar for an outright buy. You're trading the euro dollar for a buy against a pound dollar for a sell because the value is too high. The value is too much. The hedgers have too much room to make a lot of money on this trade, more money than any hedger has been able to make on any other trade. If you look at this trade here, for example, there was a small value divergence here, but look how much value was in it. Very, very little, right? When we sold into that sell, the pound had only just started to diverge off the highs here. So because the pound had only just started to diverge off the high, nobody's in a spread trade here, Miguel. There's nobody in a spread. So obviously when that spread starts working on the short side, the actual sell-off is absolutely fantastic and we make a lot of money, right? We make a lot of money because that's where the spreaders are not involved. So when you're looking at it from a pure order flow point of view, this also made perfect sense because there was no selling coming in. If there's no selling coming in, obviously leaning against any selling is going to be a reasonable opportunity, a reasonable proposition. So these sellers that came in here when the sell order flow was coming in the book, that looks like a spoof. It gets some sellers, they ice up the sellers in here, they ice up the sellers and the price goes back up again. So you could have taken a buy against those three levels. Now, obviously, the buy should always be against the lowest possible price. You don't want to pay as high a price as possible. You want the lowest possible price. So that's where your buy trade would have been just here, probably around about 18.37. So you're paying, you're bidding 37s for this one, and it's obviously gone up a little bit. You've made some scratch trade money. Worst case scenario, a scratch trade just there. It's just common sense, guys, isn't it, when you think about it? So if you're practicing with it on demo, practice it. Muck about with it for a while. We're 20 minutes ahead of the oil, guys, 20 minutes ahead of the oil. So we'll be focused on that when the oil price comes out to play. So let's catch up with the oil. Let's do some bigger picture analysis. That was a good Aussie and Canadian long, by the way. Very, very good. Okay, so when you're doing bigger picture analysis, the chart you want to be looking at is the hourlies or the half hourlies. You want to look at what's changed, what caused the oil to make a move higher, what were you thinking about when the oil broke higher. In the early stages, of course, this was a kind of hedge trade against the inflation break-evens. Oil had to either drop or the break-evens had to rise. It was going to have to be either or. Now, one of the things that we saw from the markets was that the gas market actually went higher quite considerably as well. Remember that. Natural gas is part of the energy complex. You can look at other oil markets like Gush, for example, or you can look at the petroleum exploration crowd. But anyway, you can look at Gush, and you can obviously see that Gush has been very, very bullish. This is obviously a very, very, very strong correlation to oil prices. You can see that Gush opened with a very strong gap up today, and it's been bullish ever since. And that's one way of analyzing. That's one way of analyzing oil, isn't it? So we've got some elements. We've got some elements. This is the S&P oil and gas exploration. Two times. It's a leveraged product. And it should obviously be very, very strongly correlated to, should be a very strong correlation to oil prices themselves. So when we look at Gush, we can see that Gush is definitely bullish this morning, but we didn't know that because last night, of course, it closed relatively low in the water. So that's obviously got to be something you're looking at. When we're looking at the markets, one of the things we're always asking the big questions about is, well, what is the shape of the market? What is the overall sentiment? What are, for example, the yields doing? What are the commodity currencies doing? When we look at the commodity currencies, you can see the commodity currencies and oil are very strongly related, but you can see there's been a slight breakdown in the last few weeks. We can see that commodity prices rallied when oil prices were very, very weak here. And obviously since then, commodity prices have actually came off because of perhaps some of the pushback against higher yields. Oil prices, however, have obviously extended their gains to the upside, rather unusually perhaps. But obviously there's some Russians and the Arabs up to their funny business. That's okay, we can understand that. So what else do we look at? Well, there's a lot of other things we can look at. We can look at the calendar spreads, the big macro calendars, to try and figure out what the calendars have for us. This is oil 3 minus F, G and H. So this is a big calendar spread here. And obviously we've got macro sell side, haven't we? We've got lots of macro sell side, but we've got micro buy side. It's very difficult to be a seller against the micro buyers. So whilst we've got macro sales, and we've got a lot of macro sales, the last time we were at this level, of course, was over here. But the oil prices are way above that level, aren't they? They're way above that. This price was about $70 a barrel with that calendar spread just there. Now, obviously, we're at $73 a barrel. We are a good, definitely a good $3,000 overpriced on oil. 100%. So there's a big oil trade for me setting up. It's just I'm patiently waiting for it. And then I'll absolutely annihilate everybody that bought the market and hasn't closed off their trades pretty soon. But what else are we looking at? Is oil cheap or expensive? Well, let's take a look at natural gas, first of all, to see the relationship that gas has. Now, this is obviously one of the big drivers we've seen in oil recently. This is the NG contract. So is it oil that's mad or is it natural gas that's mad? Now, there is a crossover between these two products, right? There is a crossover. There is a switch value in oil and gas. It's not a... A lot of people think, just switch off the gas and switch on the oil if it's cheap. It's not as easy as that. There's a lot of costs involved in switching. But obviously, they're still both part of the same exploration, aren't they? If there's a squeeze on gas prices, there's usually a squeeze on oil prices. So one of the things that we can understand is that if gas prices are exploding north, oil prices will probably explode north, because oil is gas, oil and gas come from the a lot of the times come from the same wells at times. So when we look at this idea, we can understand that this is going to drag oil prices higher simply because it does have a switchable value attached to it. It's not the best idea, but it's certainly an idea. Put it this way, I would rather be a buyer of oil if gas prices were going higher than if gas prices were going, well, that should be pretty sensible. It's the same as gas prices. I'd rather be a buyer of gas prices if oil prices were going higher than if oil prices were going lower. So it's a simple kind of conclusion, whether the gas market or the oil market has its own drivers or not. It's a simple conclusion that you can reach about what you would rather be doing in certain circumstances. So with gas prices as bullish as they are, and they've obviously extended their bullishness today, the chances are that oil prices might simply just follow suit, not because there's any real bulls in the oil market, it's just because the gas prices are going up so much. And I think that's probably true of what we've seen today. I think it's been gas driven rather than oil. So that's obviously creating some demand in the oil calendar, so that's okay, we can understand that as well. The big thing is, of course, is it killing the crack spread? Because that's one of the things that could cut this oil price off quickly, couldn't it? If the crack spread gets mauled by higher oil prices, the chances are that the refiners will cut off the demand. Think about it. What happens if your margins go down to zero? What happens if your margins reach zero? You'd just stop buying stuff, wouldn't you? You wouldn't do any business. You would go to the oil companies and say, look, I can't make any money on this oil that you're selling me at this price. I can't make any money on this $73 oil. So what I'm asking you to do is you've got to cut your prices by $2 or $3. So obviously this is what we start to look for. We start to look for the crack spread getting absolutely mauled by the oil price during that process, don't we? So we can obviously start looking for whether that's putting too much pressure into the crack spread. So that's pretty easy. You can analyze that very, very easily by simply looking at the crack spread as a standalone. So here's the problem. The crack spread isn't getting mauled. The crack spread is rubbish for this whole higher oil price phase here, isn't it? The crack spread is definitely rubbish at the moment. I mean, the oil refiners must be pissed off with $20 a barrel at $73 oil. So, you know, you can obviously understand this idea, but they're not getting mauled. And because they're not getting mauled, they don't really care. They're able to, at the moment, they're able to pass on the extra oil cost onto the public. They're able to pass it on to the oil buyers, the petroleum buyers, the heating oil, the jet engine buyers, the jet oil, the all the derivative products. They're able to pass that on. That's why the crack spread is staying neutral. Make sense? So one of the things you could see, for example, in this area, as the oil price rallied, the crack spread got mauled. So the ability for them to keep passing on that crack, that higher oil price, was getting less and less and less. Well, that's not what's happening just now on oil. The crack spread is staying relatively perky at higher oil prices, and that's going to allow the buyers of oil to keep confirming that they'll take more oil, even at higher prices, right? Make sense? Let's take a look at the Brent oil combination, whether it's a WTI picture or a Brent oil picture. Well, there's another picture that's relatively in line with what you would expect. You can see that it's having a bit of a negative impact, but Brent seems to be keeping track with the WTI, isn't it? It's getting towards the bottom of the bracket now. You can see that it's getting towards the bottom of the bracket. But it's certainly not at the bottom of the bracket. It's certainly not having a negative impact on the price at this stage, is it? So this is something we start watching. So for example, this is a good phase here to watch here. You can see that as oil prices started to move a little bit higher, it was having a negative, a really, really big negative impact on the Brent WTI spreads here. See that? A really negative impact on the spreads. What does that mean? Well, that means that people will stop buying WTI and they'll switch to Brent, which is a very, very similar sulfur level. The switching cost might be worth their while changing their order book from a WTI contract to a Brent contract. Now, it's not a huge change, but put it this way, if I buy the difference here, if I buy Brent, I'm paying $4 more. Whereas if I buy Brent here, I'm paying $3 more. I'm getting it basically a dollar cheaper than it was before. So there might be a reason for me to switch off my buying of WTI at higher prices and start buying Brent oil at higher prices. The Brent WTI spread is now visible. So this is something we start paying attention to, isn't it? The direction of oil against the other parts to the jigsaw puzzle. But it's not been that negative on Brent so far in this rally, which means Brent's also rallying strongly. Put those together, and it's very difficult to see a reason to sell oil. What else? Euro dollar. Is it expensive? On a macro scale, of course, we can see that on a big macro scale, oil is very expensive on any higher price. We can see that looking at the euro dollar's been on a very, very gradual grind lower ever since the beginning of time here, by the looks of it. But it's actually only a couple of months. But obviously, the bigger the divergence between these, the more expensive the real oil price is for the global economy. So obviously, when you start seeing oil making these higher highs through these phases, you start thinking to yourself, this is damned expensive, guys. There's no way they're going to sustain this type of trade. Very expensive for the Europeans. Probably very expensive for the Chinese. Euro dollar and China dollar usually pretty much doing the same thing, but you can check that simply by clicking on the dollar China for a second and ask the question, is it roughly about the same thing? And the answer is, yeah, it's roughly about the same thing. The kind of orange line there is the China dollar. So when we look at the China dollar, yes, it's a little bit better than the euro. So the euro's probably a little bit overly weak, but still nonetheless, oil is expensive at higher prices for the global economy. So this is going to certainly put some pressure onto oil at higher prices, that's for sure. But where are those higher prices? Well, of course, one of the things we have to do is once we start breaking through some of these key levels, as we start to look for those toxic reversals, we start to look for the last commercial sell zones, right? Oil's one of the best charts that you'll ever see for toxicity. You can see the fast candle breaks everywhere they happen. You can see where they come from, the candle reversals, where they come from there, for example. The candle reversals, where they come from there, for example. The candle reversals, where they come from there, for example. You can see these become key reference prices for traders. These are where commercial buyers have changed to commercial sellers, toxic tradable areas. So when we recognize these toxic tradable areas, all of a sudden, things become very, very simple, don't they? All we've got to do is remember these price areas as key references. As we go forward, of course, you'd have been aware of that key level there when that sell came in for a very, very sizable, $5,000-$6,000 of profit. But obviously, since then, we've managed to move the needle again, and there was another toxic seller here and blah, blah, blah. But obviously, that's not as relevant as trying to figure out what's happening on the right-hand edge. Well, guess where we've just touched? Guess where we've just touched? That background toxic sell level. So there is a sell level right here on oil. Is it going to stick at this price? Or is it going to say, what the hell's happening? Is it going to finish off at that price? Is there going to be a flurry of activity around about $73 that's going to give us a big sell-off coming in here? Well, the commercials have been involved before at this price, absolutely. But as I said before, there's got to be a reason. There's got to be a reason. People must be thinking oil's expensive. We know that against the dollar it's expensive. Against the crack spread and against the Brent WTI spread, it doesn't seem to be gaining in any particular expense. It seems to be passed on to the other markets. So that's always going to be a reason why the market isn't going to sell off here. But this is a key technical price. And based on this key technical price, at least you're looking for the right stuff to happen at this price to sell it off. Pretty easy stuff, guys, yeah? Pretty easy stuff. Now, obviously, I've got my own inside book, of course. I've got my own inside book. I can start looking for any trade that's taking place against that oil level. And at the moment, short term, there's a few buyers coming in, but there is a macro sell in this area. So I am a short seller of oil at these prices at the moment. Just for completeness, I am a short seller, but obviously it's just coming into the numbers just now. And we'll see how that trade evolves, if at all.